In this episode, my friend Greg Emilio joins me once again to talk about movies. You might remember Greg. We recently talked about Roma. And then earlier in the year, we discussed Patterson. This time, though, we decided to talk about three movies that stood out for each of us during the last decade, from 2010 to the end of 2019, just a few days ago. My three selections are what you would call mainline Hollywood-type movies that use conventional storytelling techniques, while Greg's picks offer a nice contrast as he reviews three beautiful films that tell their stories in a more poetic mode. So I'm just going to get started. I only wanted to say here that normally I have my guest say a few words before we get going, but it didn't work out in the editing for me to do that this time, so you're going to hear me talking first for a few minutes. Sorry about that, Greg, but don't worry, he shows up soon enough.
You're listening to
a small good thing
with Steve Zell.
So what's our how do we want to do this? First, we make clear that we're not trying to say these are the best movies, like some big objective standard that's going to compete with the Academy or the Golden Globes or something like that. We're saying that we're looking over the last 10 years. It's New Year's, day after New Year's, and we're just sort of surveying the last decade of movies and what maybe three movies were memorable to you, three movies memorable to me, and talking about those a little bit, why they're memorable to us, we can get to that, and why we think they should be movies that last and people should see. Why don't we do it this way then, Greg? We'll start with, we'll do the countdown, you know, third, second, and then our first picks, and then maybe we can alternate. So I'll start out. My third pick for most memorable movie of the decade is The King's Speech. It's a 2010 movie. It was nominated and won Best Movie of the Year at the Academy Award. It's directed by Tom Hooper. He did other movies like Les Miserables, and he did the television series for HBO called John Adams. Very good. The movie stars Colin Firth, Geoffrey Rush, he's an Australian, and Helena Bonham Carter. The synopsis is Britain's Prince Albert, that would be the reigning Queen Elizabeth's father. He must ascend the throne as King George VI, but he has a speech impediment. Knowing that the country needs her husband to be able to communicate effectively, Elizabeth hires a fellow named Lionel Logue, that's Geoffrey Rush. He is an Australian actor and a speech therapist to help the king overcome his stammer. An extraordinary friendship develops between the two men as Logue uses unconventional means to teach the monarch how to speak with confidence. I think the thing that stands out on this movie, Greg, is frankly, it's big. It's a crowd pleaser. The Academy liked it. Some of the critics stuck up their noses. They wanted to have, I think it was called The Social Connection. Was that what it was called? Do you remember?
Oh, the one about Facebook?
Yep.
The Social Network.
The Social Network. That a lot of critics felt that that was a more deserving picture. I think they think that because the Academy tends to like socially, politically, and culturally important movies. And The King's Speech wasn't that, but it was big. What stands out about the movie to me, and why do I think it's a worthy movie to see? Well, it's just a flat-out good movie. These are the best actors in the world at the top of their game. The sets are big. It's England. It's the palace. It's full of history. It's before the war. So it has all those elements in the movie that makes it a big movie and a pleasant movie to watch. And I think it will have longevity because it's rooted deeply in British history. But it's a personal drama. For me, the reason I've chosen it, it has to do with that friendship. What's really great that Tom Hooper and the writers do with this is that it develops, there's this kind of big, small. He's the monarch. And Lionel Logue, he's uncredentialed. So these two men begin to form a bond around helping the king with his speech. And finally, he succeeds. And we get to follow that. So at the end, it's heartwarming as well as, it's entertaining. It's got all those bits. So that's why I've chosen it. And I still think it's worthy of seeing. Did you ever get to see it?
I did, actually. I liked it quite a bit.
Yeah, it was a popular movie, and it was right at the beginning of the decade.
Yeah.
That's my third pick. What's your third pick?
Okay. It's hard. I didn't really have them in order of kind of in any kind of order, so maybe I can just do...
You can invent
I'll start with this one. A movie called Ex Machina, which came out in 2014. It's a sci-fi movie written and directed by Alex Garland. It's his first feature. And this movie was pretty well received, got a lot of good praise. It won an Oscar for best special effects, which was cool because it doesn't really have a whole lot of, it doesn't have any explosions. It doesn't have a big, it doesn't have much CGI. So the effects are real quiet, but the movie's about a computer programmer named Caleb who works for a company called Blue Book, which is essentially a stand-in for Google. And Caleb kind of wins this contest to spend a week hanging out with the creator of Blue Book, named Nathan, and he's played by Oscar Isaac. So he wins this experience to go hang out with him in kind of this compound that is in the middle of nowhere. It looks to be somewhere like in Alaska, so in the middle of the wilderness. And when he gets there, he's informed by his boss, Nathan, that the reason why he's there is because Caleb is going to perform a Turing test with artificial intelligence, kind of a humanoid robot named Ava.
I've heard of the Turing test. What's the brief explanation of that?
The Turing test comes from, the namesake comes from Alan Turing, and it's a who I think was recently, not recently, but the movie The Imitation Game was about Alan Turing.
Right.
But the test is, it's a test where a human has a conversation with artificial intelligence and attempts to find out if that artificial intelligence is human or not. So, yeah, if the test is passed, then the AI is fully conscious, I guess, in a way, and it mimics human behavior so well as to be undetected. So in this movie, he's testing to see the owner or the creator of Blue Book, who has also created this brand new AI, is trying to see if his AI is capable of near human or human consciousness. And Caleb is the guy who gets to have the conversations with the AI, Ava. I'd say it's a surprisingly human movie for the subject of artificial intelligence. I think it's memorable because the movie's basically just, it's very minimalistic. It's stripped down. There's only essentially three characters, and almost the entire movie is just dialogue. So it's just about conversations that these three figures are having together. But the movie, I think, is really, really smart, kind of from a conceptual point of view, because it's essentially kind of like this postmodern retelling of the Garden of Eden. So you've got the creator of Google or Blue Book, Nathan, is kind of like a godlike figure. You know, he's creating human, or he's creating artificial intelligence. And then Ava, the AI, her name pretty much echoes Eve. And then you've got this male character who's kind of standing for Adam. And so I just thought it was a really clever way to update that that narrative, but for the 21st century, when we have to start trying to reckon with artificial intelligence and what it's going to mean for humanity when we continue to create these things, and when they become as smart or perhaps more smart and just as conscious as us.
Okay, so switching to my number two, a completely different kind of movie than yours. It's not a sci-fi movie. And again, another popular movie, Moneyball. And it was made in 2011. It's interesting. The ones I've picked are very, very early in the decade. It was nominated for Best Picture. It did not win, but it won some other awards, I think, for Brad Pitt. It was directed by a guy named Bennett Miller. It was written by Alan Sorkin, who probably is now our greatest living screenwriter, but also a guy named Steve Zalian. Great, great script. It stars Brad Pitt, Jonah Hill, the late, great Philip Seymour Hoffman, and Robin Penn Wright. It is about the Oakland A's GM, Billy Bean, who is handicapped with the lowest salary constraint in baseball. If he ever wants to win the World Series, Billy must find a competitive advantage. Billy is about to turn baseball on its ear when he uses statistical data to analyze and place value on the players he picks for the team. One of the things that stands out for me is the music. It's by a guy named Michael Dana. I'd never heard of him. But the music works really, really well. It's very, very low key. It's very subliminal. It works very well when we are looking at just images of Brad Pitt sitting by himself. It wants to be meditative. It wants to be stirring. It's not grand. It's not loud. It's kind of emphasizing the inner life of Brad Pitt's character. And the music, maybe I'll stick on some of this music for my podcast. They don't like me to do that because it's copyrighted, but it's a wonderful kind of music. That sticks out. Jonah Hill. I can't say that I've seen a lot of Jonah Hill movies, and probably he's been in movies that I wouldn't normally be attracted to, but he's the sidekick here, and he does just a bang-up job in this part. It's also a baseball story. It's got that going for it. So it has those things that the Academy Awards like, as well as popular audiences. When we think of baseball stories, you really can't go wrong. You think of Field of Dreams or Clint Eastwood's recent Trouble with the Curve. And this is a story about underdogs. It's a baseball team filled with guys who basically are bought on the cheap by other teams that don't want them anymore. So it's fabulous. I like it because, yes, baseball's going on. Yes, there's this surface story going on. But for me, what rings true is the kind of story about this man who is struggling with, I don't know how to say it, unrealized potential or promise, of trying to connect with what he knows he can do, but so far apparently in his life has not been realized. And so this is a movie about a guy trying to prove something to himself, and maybe himself first and foremost, and others down the road. What about your second pick?
Number two, I'll go with Birdman. This is a movie from 2014. It won the Best Picture, and I think also Best Director that year. It stars Michael Keaton as a washed-up superhero actor who kind of is really kind of down and out and is using the last of his money and energy and ability to try to mount a theatrical production of a Raymond Carver short story called What We Talk About When We Talk About Love. To me, it's a real zeitgeist kind of film. I think it really captures the spirit of our day and age, in which the biggest kind of narratives that we get to experience are superhero movies. And this kind of even precedes some of the mega blockbusters that we have going on right now. So I love how smart it is in its setup, that it is about someone from that kind of world, right? The world of superhero characters. Michael Keaton, you know, it's not a coincidence he was also the star of Batman, right? So he comes, it's a very good casting to have him in this role as somebody who's a washed up, you know, superhero actor. But he's trying to like cast off his old identity as just a Batman, and he's trying to make what, you know, we might call high art. He's going for the theater. And not just the theater, but he's trying to adapt a short story into, you know, a theatrical production. So for me, the movie just has a lot to say about like what is the value of kind of high art as we, you know, as we roll ahead into these big Hollywood productions? You know, like I think we are losing a lot of connection to small, intimate art like the theater, like poetry. And this movie kind of wants to take, I think, in some ways, a stand against that and kind of really affirm the value of those kinds of art forms. And I don't think it's a warning, but it does kind of, I think it does point at like what will be lost if we lose those kinds of art forms. And yeah, so I think the movie's really worthwhile because of that. But it's also just has a really good cast, is very funny, and it's also technically interesting because the whole movie is made to appear as a single take. So there are no cuts in this movie. You've got one camera that roves around the entire film and essentially never blinks its eye. And so I thought it was just visually quite quite arresting, quite neat.
That's interesting. So this is one of those movies that is somewhat of an irony. It's a movie about saying, you know, we need to pay attention to these smaller or perhaps fading arts. So we're watching the thing that maybe is the enemy almost. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean it's a movie about a play about a short story. So it's like Russian nesting dolls kind of.
I'm going to go for what I remember and still I watch once a year. It came out in 2011, and the movie I've chosen won no Academy Awards, wasn't nominated for any Academy Awards. It's called Win Win, and it stars Paul Giamatti, Bobby Cannavale, and Amy Ryan. It's directed by a guy named Tom McCarthy. He wrote and directed it. He'd done a couple of movies before that, one called The Station Agent and one called The Visitor. Excellent, excellent small movies before 2010. And then he came online and won the Academy Award for a movie called Spotlight. This is a story about, it's about a regular guy. It's about a small town. There's nothing big about this movie, and I suspect that's why it didn't show up on the radar screen for the Academy Awards. There's no big music. There's no big sets. It doesn't happen on a coastal city. It's about a small town guy. He's an attorney, and he's a little disheartened. He moonlights as a high school wrestling coach because his own practice is struggling. And while he does, I'm reading this, he stumbles across a star athlete through some questionable business dealings while trying to support his family. Just as it looks like he will get a double payday, the boy's mother shows up fresh from rehab, flat broke, and threatens to derail everything. But it's about a really basically a good man who is doing his best, but he's discovering that his best is not good enough. And that's very difficult, I think, to show in a movie and to portray in a convincing way. It's about a good family. It's about a good marriage where the woman and the man are mature. She's her own person. He's his own person. They both have weaknesses that they can admit to. But most of all, they solve their problems as they go along. It's about how imperfect people can not only come out okay, but they can keep on loving too. Paul Giamatti, it's an ensemble cast. He lets everybody around him shine. One of the things I like about it is you can't keep your eyes off of Amy Ryan. She was in Birdman, by the way. She
Oh, yeah.
also played Tom Hanks' wife in Bridge of Spies. She's wonderful. Every time she's on the screen, you watch her like a hawk. She's absolutely wonderful, along with Bobby Cannavale. He's the sidekick friend. He's wonderful. It's a very moving movie to me. It's about a guy who commits a petty larceny, not so that he can buy a new, bigger car, not so that he becomes famous or he can buy a bigger house. He just wants to pay the health insurance. He just wants to be able to have enough money to hire the plumber to fix the toilet. He just wants to have enough money to replace the boiler that's not working in the basement. He's this guy. And he arranges it in such a way where, quote unquote, nobody gets hurt. It's almost a win-win. He arranges it so that the state sends him a check for 1500 bucks. We're talking about 1500 bucks a month. That's it. He can't bring himself, because of his pride, to tell his family that he's in trouble. He tells his friend, but he can't tell his wife and his child, and this gets him into problems. And but at the end of the movie, he redeems himself. This is a movie about a man redeemed. There's a signature line as everything unravels for him. He's in the kitchen. His wife is, well, understandably very angry, very hurt. Things are bad now. And she says to him in a very angry tone, she said, did you ever once, when you were doing this, think about your family? And Paul Giamatti looks at her very quietly, says, all the time. And when I hear that, I always get tears in my eyes, because I think it speaks very much to what a lot of men in America are feeling today. And that is, a lot of men are demoralized and they're trying their best, and their best doesn't appear to be enough in some cases. And this is putting tremendous pressure on men and marriages and families. And I think it still has that kind of resonance. I hope it's one of those movies that will still be running in 10 years or 20 years, that will be someplace where people go, wow. Solid acting, solid writing. Again, Amy Ryan just knocks it out of the park. A wonderful, wonderful movie. That leaves it to you. What's your number one pick for the decade?
All right, number one, and again, like, not no particular order, but maybe right, I do right. like this movie yep. the best. This is The Great Beauty. So this is an Italian film that did win the Best Foreign Picture at the 2014 Academy Awards. It's directed by Paolo Sorrentino. And the lead actor is Tony Servillo. And the story is about this, he's a bit of a literary figure. He's a guy who wrote a very popular novel early on in his youth, and the movie begins on his 65th birthday, and he lives in the high society of Rome, and he's kind of a journalist. He interviews celebrities, artists, that kind of thing. So he lives in this very very privileged elite world. But what is kind of happening now at this point in his age is he's seeing kind of the vacuousness of it all. He lives in a very material world, and he's become very disillusioned with it. And so to me, it's a, you know, a subject that a lot of great movies are about, and that's just the individual's search for meaning. How do we make meaning out of life when other things fall away from us, when we realize that maybe the way we've been living is a little empty? And so kind of the movie is often juxtaposes really lively party scenes, again, in Rome, set against the backdrop of the Colosseum and stuff, and vistas like that. It's a very lavish film. But it contrasts those with very, very quiet and very austere, and I would say religious moments. Later in the movie, this main character, Jep, has a very meaningful connection with this very old nun who kind of represents a Mother Teresa-like figure. And so the movie really just does a lot of high and lows and contrasts them. To me it definitely is another zeitgeist film that captures the spirit of an age in which our kind of materialistic pursuits are running, you know, they're running out of steam. And I think when we realize that, where will we turn? And it kind of doesn't answer everything, but it's more interested in kind of the journey towards, you know, the title of the movie, The Great Beauty, and what, you know, it often reminds me of what Keats says about beauty. So beauty, truth. Truth is beauty. That is all you can know in life and all you need to know. So I think I think it's a really meaningful movie that will stand the test of time. It's also a pretty direct homage to Federico Fellini's movie La Dolce Vita. So it has a whole lot of kind of echoes of that movie, and in the way that that movie encapsulates a similar kind of struggle for a character who is very privileged, very well off, just becoming dispirited and disillusioned with these trappings of modernity and wants to find something higher, some kind of spiritual calling or purpose. So yeah, I absolutely love it. It's just an extremely gorgeous movie. I don't think you'll find a more beautifully shot movie in the last decade. And it does it in service of, I think, a really true human kind of problem and pursuit. So yeah, I can't recommend it enough.
Maybe we can get together for a 2019 pick as the Oscars approach. I think they're in March now. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. Let's do it.
Thanks, pal.
Thanks. Take it easy.